Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Very nice to see you all. Lovely, as I said, to see some familiar faces this afternoon. And also, so welcome to all of you who've been to any of Work Avenue's webinars or any other events before now. Welcome back. And to those of you for whom this is the first visit to Work Avenue, welcome very much to you as well. This afternoon's webinar is entitled How to Build Resilience in the Workplace. Before we get on to that, I'd like to just cover a few regular housekeeping rules for webinar activity. And I kind of feel that it's, you know, it's virtually been a year since we've all been doing webinars. And over the course of the year, we've all developed very, very good and very, very strong webinar protocols. So as ever, I would respectfully ask that you all stay on mute, you know, during the course of the webinar. That would be very, very much appreciated. If you have a question, it would be much, much appreciated if you could just pop your question in the chat, you know, that would, you know, because that will make it easier for me to manage. If for some reason, I do know that one or two of you find it difficult to use the chat for various reasons. If that's the case, at a suitable moment, raise your hand using the hand raise function, and I'll be very, very happy to address your question. We won't be addressing questions throughout the webinar, but at certain break points, you know, I'll ask Simon, our guest this afternoon, whether he's happy to take questions, and I'm sure he will be on occasion. And so he's nodding, that's good. And certainly at the end, we will certainly have a time to address questions as well. So thank you very much for that. It's been a bit of a year, hasn't it? I don't really want to dwell on the fact that it's been a bit of a year for all the reasons that, you know, quite frankly, we've talked about nothing else but this for the space of a year. But I think what we can say is that the year has tested us in so many ways, for many of us to the limits of our coping strategies one way and another. It's been really a very, very challenging time. Our resilience has been tested very, very much. And it's been tested whether we're in the workplace or whether we're looking to get into the workplace. And sometimes the two interact with each other, sometimes they're unrelated. But the principle of working towards building up your coping strategies and building up your resilience for when the going gets tough, and by golly, it's got a bit tough, is something that we all need to think about as much as we can, because it just helps us live a better life, live a better work life, live a better personal life as well. So I'm delighted this afternoon to welcome a very good friend of Work Avenue and a very good friend of me as well, Simon Rickman, who's going to cover just this field this afternoon for us, how to build resilience in the workplace or the workspace, one or the other, or both. Simon is a member of the CIPD, the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development. As a leadership development coach and mentor, he specializes in working with individuals and teams to help them make significant change in their performance. He works directly with clients by understanding their challenges and developing workable solutions to them. And he's successfully led recruitment and HR departments and high-performing teams in companies such as Accenture, Pinsent Masons, Waitrose, American Express, as well as the not-for-profit sector and many other small companies as well. He's going to explain to us today how to manage stress and build resilience through simple and practical messages, enabling people to improve their coping mechanisms and increase their well-being, which of course is quite a brief view this afternoon, Simon. And of course, I've just realized that I've introduced for you very well. Some of you may not know who I am. My name is Emma May. I'm Director of Operations and Employment at Work Avenue, which means that all of our initiatives to help job seeking clients fall under my remit. And I also help run the charity as well. So welcome to you all this afternoon. All of you who've taken the time to join us. Simon, I'm going to hand over to you now. As I said, questions in the chat, please, or raise your hand if the chat doesn't work for you. Thanks.
Emma, thank you for that very, very kind introduction. I just realised I have made a typo, which actually isn't too bad, because it should say workplace. And what's interesting, and what's relevant about this, if I'd been doing this a year ago, I would have been mortified and thought, oh my God, well, I've wasted all my time, but I've built resilience by doing these webinars. I normally do everything face-to-face. With a lot of people like myself have had to move from the work environment in a physical office to actually doing something online. So I actually thought it made me laugh. So that was just something that made me laugh. And if you look at my strap line underneath, it says how to be stronger, how to be wiser, and how to be more capable. And indeed, that's going to come up when we talk about resilience. That's lifted from somebody's definition of resilience. And I use that with all of my webinars now. So without further ado, let me click the right buttons and we can move on. So why are we here today? Wow. The past year has transformed nearly every aspect of our world. That's something that's really hot off the press. You can get lots of really good quotes from people. It's something that I found because I do a lot of research in this area. It has transformed our world. And what that's going to look like going forward, we don't know. And of course, when we go back to what is coming up to that infamous anniversary of the 23rd of March last year, at that time, it seemed incredibly difficult. We hadn't been in that situation before. There were lots of words that were used at that time. It was something that was unusual. We hadn't experienced it. And yet when we were made aware of the roadmap by the Prime Minister just a couple of weeks ago, how much had really changed? That roadmap that we were coming out of, at least it was more positive. Vaccinations are happening, but it's proving to be just as challenging. And of course, the world has changed since the last time we had set foot in the office, and it's affected us in many different ways. I was doing my first webinars, actually 22nd of April last year, and it was on how to work from home effectively. And one of the phrases that was coming out of that time is, oh, well, we're all in the same boat. And people very quickly said, hold on a second, we're not. We're actually on the same sea, but we're all in different boats. And the reaction to this has been very individual. So for some of us, we're more tired, we're weary, we're isolated, but other people might actually find that they're more relaxed. Certainly we've been more caring, the clapping for the NHS. My wife makes, soup and biscuits for people in our row that we didn't talk to before. And some people have become more thoughtful. That's good. But the question is, what challenges are we going to be facing over the next few months? What have we learned about ourselves over the last year or so? And again, this is individual. And one of the questions is, well, are we going to go back into the office? We don't know. I've got a number of clients who are saying, we're not going to go back into the office. We've found that working from home has suited the way that we work. The thinking that we had prior to that was we couldn't possibly do this, has been blown out of the water. The money that we can save by not paying rent means that we're not going to go back into the office. On the other hand, I've got clients saying we can't wait to get back in the office. The interaction, the what we call the water cooler moments, the body language that we can't read as well, all of that kind of stuff, that stimulating stuff, we can only get in the office. So we don't know. I reckon we're going to come up with some sort of hybrid working environment. And the other question we've got is, how are we going to reconnect to our businesses and to ourselves, given that we've all had to learn how to work from home effectively, and we can shut the computer and we're in our home. All of a sudden, we're going to go back to things that we weren't used to. So that's another question. I think it's another big challenge that we're going to be facing. And then we need to check our level of drive and our focus. And of course, we need to check our level of wellness as well. And as an HR professional, we probably wouldn't have been saying that in the way that we're saying that 12 months ago. It's just interesting. And I think that there are some motivational skills that are going to be required for 2021. And I think they're here to stay. The first one is we have to be agile. We've seen that. I mentioned before that I used to do this and I will be going back to doing this face to face. But I've had to move my products, which are workshops, into webinars, coaching, much easier to be done one to one. But we've had to what we call pivot. Another one of those words that has popped up over the last 12 months. The second one is being engaged. How do we retain that level of engagement in what we do? And of course, I don't know, I'm not going to be talking about it, but how many people watched the interview of the century on Monday and looking at how it's affected two people. And there'll be a lot of people that have responded to that in a positive way. And we know there are other people have responded to that in a negative way. So that level of engagement when we're hearing these sort of challenges is just different, but I think is here to stay. And the final one, of course, is why we're here today, which is about being resilient. How can we learn from the stress and the challenges that we've experienced and turn that into something more positive? And that's really what I want to focus on today. So Emma's already covered these, so I'm going to go through these quickly. I want to make my webinars as active as possible. So we have asked you to go on mute. I'm going to use the chat icon for an exercise. So if you have got pen and paper, you don't have to do this, it's purely voluntary, but I would suggest you get that ready now. We're not going to use it quite yet, but I'll tell you when we get to that point. We will have some polling questions because I get lots of really positive feedback that people like to participate in this, and it's very interesting to hear and see what people think. And we've got those reactions. So I'm introducing some reactions, and it will be clear when I'm going to ask for a reaction from you. Let me say now that all of this is, well, the reactions aren't going to be anonymous because we can see that, but we're not taking notes of those sorts of things, but the polls will be anonymous. And as Emma said, if you can save your questions until the end, or if you're desperate, if you can't wait, put it in the chat. Emma will stop me from talking and I can try and answer your question. So for those of you who know your Stephen Covey and have been on my 7 Habits of Highly Effective Job Seekers, you'll know that habit number 2 is beginning with the end in mind. So what's our objectives for today? And the first one is, let's talk about stress. Of course, as an HR professional, I've talked about stress for many years, but a number of people don't, and it's seen as a taboo subject. And what I want to focus on here is the positive side of that, which is the building of resilience. So I'll give that some definition and context. I'm going to be providing you with a number of tools and techniques. Now, I know that you probably have heard some of them before. You may have heard all of them before. I don't know. But the idea is to pick and choose the ones that are relevant for your particular situation. And the idea, of course, is by the end of the webinar is that you can be more resilient. And what's important about what I do, it's about getting the best out of yourself. But it's also about getting the best out of other people. Other people, if you're at work, your line manager, your colleagues, your customers. But it's also relevant for our personal life as well. How do I get the best out of anybody that I interact with? And of course, one of my main objectives is to make people self-aware. As I mentioned, a number of people, you would have heard some of these things before, but maybe not in this context. And one of the things we really have been looking for this year is some sort of normality. And this is something that came up on one of the many videos that I get sent all the time. Is this what our future is going to look like when we go back to the pub? I don't know.
Hey, Chuck, how's the job search going? I got something, Sam, but I'm not crazy about it. I'm a janitor at a biology lab where they do DNA experiments, making mutant viruses and stuff. Sounds like a pretty good job to me. I don't know. It makes me a little nervous, you know, all that weird stuff floating around.
Oh, hey, don't worry about it.
Don't sweat it.
Oh, yeah, of course. I mean, they handle all that stuff. I guess you're right. Must be getting a little paranoid, huh? See you later.
Okay, Chuck.
You know, I feel better already. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Take care, Chuck.
Sammy, use a phone.
I guess once we've all had our vaccinations, none of that will be necessary. And indeed, we've had some habits that we've created over the last 12 months. And I just think some of them may just take a little bit longer for us to change. So the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People is the framework that I use on most of the workshops and the coaching that I do. And I think it's a really good framework. And I always say to my clients, do you know what you're getting 2 for the price of 1? If all I talked about was the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, ka-ching, that is the most effective way that I believe that we can live our lives. So what I'm doing is I'm taking that as the framework and saying, okay, well, let's talk about the habits or some of them, but let's talk about how those habits can help us to be resilient, to move us maybe from a situation where we're feeling somewhat stressed and out of control, and by the end of the journey to have some sort of resilience and we've got more control over our lives. So habit number one is what we call be proactive. And being proactive means that we should take responsibility for everything that happens to us. Things happen to us, but it's how we respond to them that's the most important thing. And I'll be talking a little bit about that. Then I'm going to be talking about habit number three, which is putting first things first. In other words, how do we prioritize what's really important to us? And again, I think over the last 12 months, it's helped us to really focus on what are the really important things in life. I mean, I live in Brighton. I'm very lucky. It's a lovely sunny day. It's quite windy. 10 minutes time, I can go down and be at the coast. It's brilliant. But I haven't seen my children who live in London for the last probably 4 or 5 months. So, you know, that's a priority that I've had to learn not to have. And it's tough. Then I'll talk about habit number four, which is called think win-win. So any interaction that I have with people, I need to make sure that they're getting something out of it as well as myself. And I'm going to talk to you about what we call the emotional bank account. And then finally, I'll talk about habit number seven, which is called sharpen the saw. And this is about how do we refresh ourselves? How do we keep our bodies, our minds and our spirits at a level that we can cope with all the things that are happening around us? Now, just to prove that there are seven habits, these are the other three, which unfortunately we don't have the time to talk about today, but I'll just flash them up on the screen. But before we do that, let's first of all talk about stress. Now, if you've got your pen and paper ready, I would suggest you write down Every Mind Matters, do a Google search. Don't do it now, but do it later. I might explain why.
Everyone knows that feeling when life gets on top of us. We feel stressed, low, anxious, or have trouble sleeping. We think there's nothing to be done. Nothing we can do about it.
But now, there's a new way to help turn things around. Every Mind Matters will show you simple ways to look after your mental health.
It'll get you started with a free online plan designed to help you deal with stress, boost your mood, improve your sleep, and feel more in control.
We could all benefit from taking simple steps to look after our mental health.
Every Mind Matters.
We're in this together.
Come on.
What, I mean, it's this, I've been showing that video since April last year. It came out in October of 2019. And for those of you who have picked up, the voiceovers on that video are the four younger royal members of the royal family, which is given what happened on Monday, it's kind of interesting from that perspective. It just, I guess, from my perspective, a nice coincidence. It's a really good site. There are five questions that they ask you. You answer them honestly and they give you some suggestions if you are feeling stressed. It's very good. I recommend it to all my clients. And the key thing here is that stress is a normal part of our lives. And I took the definition by the NHS, why not? And what the NHS says is it's the body's reaction to feeling threatened or under pressure. It's very common. Hooray. You know, I'm not unusual. And it can be motivating. Indeed, it needs to be motivating to help us achieve things in our daily life. And that is what I call the good stress. And that good stress can help us meet those demands of home, work and life. Having those deadlines, having those targets, things that need to be done, if we can manage them, that's done through the good stress. However, too much stress can affect our mood and our body and our relationships, especially when we feel out of control, which I'm sure all, if not most of us, have felt at some point in our lives. And it's at that point, I call that the bad stress. And that bad stress is what makes us feel anxious. It makes us feel irritable with ourselves and with other people. And it also can affect how we look at ourselves, our self-belief and our self-esteem. Now, if we take this into a work environment, I've got here what is called the inverted U model. You can see that because it looks like an upside down U. And Yerkes and Dobson actually created this in 1903 or 1905. So it's been around for over 100 years. And you can see that there's a relationship between performance on the left-hand side and pressure on on the bottom. And if we have low pressure, we can get bored. We can feel guilty. We can feel lazy. And a new word that it was in one of the webinars I was listening to, I hadn't heard it before, but I like it. It's called rust out. I'm not being utilized to enough. And therefore I start to slow down. I start to rust up. And we can see as you increase pressure and you increase performance, it gets to a point which is what we call the optimal performance. That's the time when we can do what we want to do, what we need to do to a level that's acceptable from ourselves and for whoever we're doing it for. That's the desired point. But if we increase that pressure, you can see that what happens is that our performance starts to tail downwards. And that's when we start to feel that anxiety, the burnout, the unhappiness. And that's where we don't want to be. And so when I talked about that bad stress, that's at either extreme. It's not just the stress that it's the top right, but I also think it's at the bottom left as well. And I've been in both situations, so I know how it feels like. And that bit in the middle is what we call that good stress. So what I just want you to be aware of is, what do we need to look out for in ourselves and also in other people? And there are various symptoms. They're the emotional symptoms. If you feel that you're out of control, that you can see that people are lonely or get agitated and frustrated, that's a warning sign. Physically, if people are getting headaches or upset stomachs or they're not sleeping, that's a physical symptom. Behaviorally, if people's appetites change, which could be eating a lot, which a lot of people have done, or not eating enough, or fidgeting, or increasing their intake of alcohol, drug smoking, things like that, that's a telltale sign. And the final one is the cognitive. So this is when people start to worry, particularly those people who didn't used to worry before. They saw that stress as a positive and now it's become a negative. Or they start to forget things. All of these are the red flags, the telltale signs. So I'm going to go to our first poll of the webinar, and I'm just going to launch the poll for you. And I just want to ask you the question. Again, this is anonymous, I promise you. In the last few months, have you experienced any of these symptoms? So I'm going to give you 30 seconds to answer, which is normally about the right amount of time to give people. I can see people already clicking away, which is great. Okay, we have 5 more seconds. 4, 3, 2, 1. There's still some people. Oh, they're going in. Go on. I won't click yet. I'll wait. They're still clicking away. So I'm going to be patient. I've learned to be patient. Oh, and somebody's come into the room as well, which is great. Right, I'm going to stop it now. We've got 83% voted, which is great. I'm going to end the poll. Right, let me share the results with you. So, first of all, nobody here has had none of the symptoms, which is not surprising given the situation that we've experienced. The majority are getting this some of the time, but a third of us most of the time, and about 10, just over 10% of us all of the time. So that is typical. That's not surprising. So if it makes you feel better, which hopefully it will do, that's not a surprise. So it's how we actually deal with this. It's how we manage it. So let me stop the sharing there. Okay. So now one way of trying to understand this is through the changes that we've had. And we've had a lot of change in the last 12 months. So some of you may be familiar with the Kubler-Ross change curve. It's normally used when we experience grief, but any type of significant change, it's the same. And you can see there's a reaction which will change depending on who you are, and the time that you spend at each stage will vary. So there's I can't be prescriptive on that. So if we go back to March the 23rd in 2020, the first thing we all experience is what are you kidding? This is crazy. It's happening to some place called Wuhan in China. That's thousands of miles away, and all of a sudden it's happening to Spain, and then Italy, and then, oh my God, it's happening to us. And that's the first thing that we get. We then move to the next state, which is denial. It's okay, look, okay, fine. It's not really happening. It'll be over in a few months. Yeah. And we realize that actually that is not the case. So we start to go into self-doubt, and we're thinking, well, The word I didn't use, and I've forgotten it, but of course I remember it now, is these are unprecedented times. That was the statement. It's unprecedented times. Well, what are we going to do? We've never been in this situation before. From my personal situation, you know, I had a fantastic pipeline of work and then it all disappeared because everything was going in the office. Debenhams are shut down. All of these types of things, we can't, we're self-doubt. What can we do? And what can happen is that we then go into what we call apathy. We can become apathetic. We start to not do anything because we feel that we can't. And if we allow ourselves to stay in that situation, it's what is called the valley of despair. And we have to start thinking differently to acknowledge and say, okay, well, we are where we are. It is what it is. All these phrases that are coming out. Do you know what? We've got a really good NHS. What can we do to move out of this situation? So we have got lots of experience in other things that are related to this. So let's take some stock and let's move on. Let's accept where we are and let's start to think more positively about where we're going to be. Now, when I was doing this in the summer of last year, 2020, and I would have one here, I'd have another poll here. And I say, where are you at the moment? And most people will say, they're kind of 5, 6 and 7. Yes, great. But look what happens. We go into lockdown 2, we go into lockdown 3. And what happens is we go back into shock and we then go through the curve. Now, this time we probably go through it a bit quicker because we have become more resilient, because we understand that we're going to go through this. But it's something that we've seen happen. So something I'm just asking you, if you want to make a note of it, is just check, what stage are you at? If you're at stage 4, you need to think about, how do I move to these other stages? If I'm at stage 6 or 7, how do I continue to be at those stages? If I go into shock, what do I need to do to move myself through this curve? And of course, we've all been coping very differently over the last 12 months. For some, I mentioned at the beginning, it's been a benefit, but for others, it's been challenging. So here's some research that I've done. 56% of workers surveyed were happier working from home. Great. That was done in December, very recently. Never before in modern history have so many parents spent so much time in place with their children. Never before. Maybe going back to caveman, I don't know. Yeah, or they say modern history. Actually, I studied modern history, I should know that. It's not caveman, it's not modern, I'm sorry. But the point is that it's something that we're benefiting from. I have a dog, and other people have got dogs. Our pets are used to us being at home. It's lovely. Analysis shows that global CO2 emissions have fallen by 7%. It was just a bit different, but I thought, you know, that's really cool, because all we've heard over the last 20 years of how that's damaging us, it's actually beginning to fall. That's all on the good side. On the challenging side, the third lockdown has triggered an unprecedented crisis in mental health issues, only in December. It's going to take us some time to come out of that. Optimism about when life will return to normal has declined in early 2021. So although we're hearing about the vaccinations, great, but it's still taking time. We just don't know. My wife and I booked a holiday for February of 2022. We're kind of hoping that we can go on our Caribbean cruise. Who knows? Up to 10 million people in England will require new or additional mental health support. This thing is not going to go away. This is only in January, right? This isn't going to go away. So organisations and individuals need to learn, how can we cope better? So just for a bit of fun, I want you to go to the reactions button. And I'd like to know whether you're thinking more on the left-hand side, you're thinking of the positive benefit side, or you're more thinking about the downsides and that's affecting you more. So if you want to go to the reactions and let's see, and I'm going to have a look at the screen with Emma and just see if we get any reactions from people. Okay, so we're getting some thumbs up and hands and things, and some clapping hands. And we're getting some, I love that face. It makes me laugh. That's why I had to use that one. So at the moment, I'm just looking at one screen. So we've got a few screens here. So I'm just going to scroll through. Okay, looks, it's about 50-50. Okay, so yeah, again, that's typical, is that some of us are seeing the benefits and some are not. And so it's about me. It's about you. What are the typical causes of stress? And there's a number of them. The first one that challenges us are the number of roles that we have to perform. So you may be a manager or a leader, you may be a wife and a mother and a daughter or a carer, or you, like me, you play tennis at the local club, which is shut, or you volunteer. All those sort of hats that you've had to wear in normal times, that's challenged, that's been challenged. It could be your work environment. It could be the pressures and demands. There could be competing priorities. You might have, my daughter works for CST, plug, plug, great charity. Thank you for CST, it's brilliant. But she just has these back-to-back Zoom meetings. Then I'm not talking about CST now, but people find it difficult to talk about well-being. That's going to be a big challenge. All those sort of things might be affecting your stress. It could be your interpersonal stress, the psychological. There might be people in the team that you just don't like. It happens. You might not get on with your line manager. I've been living 24/7 with my wife for the last 12 months, and despite 37 years of marriage, it is a challenge. Although I actually think we've really done quite well. But that's been a challenge for a lot of people. The Prime Minister mentions it. It could be the emotional. Now, we know that there are some people who are just born to be able to cope with this better than others. But some people might just naturally, for whatever reason, might have low self-esteem, or they might be anxious, they might get depressed, whereas other people are able to deal with that better. There may be societal or cultural or social reasons. Now, I think I'm safe in saying that we're talking to a Jewish environment. I was born and bred in Northwest London. I know what it's like, the Jewish environment in Northwest London. I went to JFS, I went to Manchester University. It's a challenge in itself, keeping up with the Cohens. That is a challenge in itself. Back in 1990, my younger brother told his wife he was going for a job in Brent Cross and he didn't come back for 6 years. He couldn't cope. Thank God he's fine now. It happens, and these things are going to happen. We put that pressure on ourselves. And the last one is the physical, because we're not taking care of ourselves. I mentioned before, we might be eating too much or not enough or whatever. So I'd just like to know from you, we're going to go to another poll. But
before we do that, Simon, one of our delegates today, Bernice, has her hand up. I'm guessing she would prefer not to use the chat. Bernice, I do see your hand up. Did you want to ask a question? No, I don't think she does. In fact, I don't see her there. Maybe I can.
It might be an overspill from when
she... Yes. I'm going to lower her hand for her. There we go. Carry on.
Okay, let's go to poll number 2, causes of stress. Again, I promise you, this is anonymous. All I see are numbers. I'm not interested in names. It doesn't matter. So I'd like to know, what's the main cause of your bad stress? So if you're thinking about what's the stress that, you know, don't get me wrong, there'll be multiples, I know that, but that makes it a bit too complicated. What's the one thing that really is causing you the biggest stress? Again, I'll leave it open. Okay, we got to our 30 seconds very quickly, but I'm getting used to you lot, so I'm gonna leave it open a bit longer, because I can see people are voting, and that's the most important thing. Okay, we've got 74%. That's lovely. Let me stop it now. Oh, a bit more. I'm going to end it now. It's just for fun, but it's interesting. So it's interesting. So I'm going to share the results with you. And look, we can see the largest number, the majority, over a third of you, it's that emotional stress. It's something that either inherently you can or you can't cope with it. The next large number is the physical. And so it's those coping mechanisms, what's happening with that, the interpersonal. In fact, all of them, there's at least one person in all of them. In other words, in terms of empathizing and understanding where other people's stress has come from, where our stress has come from, that's another important lesson that we're learning in this situation. So let me just close the poll. Thank you very much for doing that. So we've talked about stress. Now let's talk about resilience. What is resilience? So that quote, that stronger, wiser, more capable, that's where it comes from. It's how do we adapt to these tough times? And what we know is that resilient people, they use positive emotions to recover from stressful situations. And so that's the bit that we need to learn from. And the good news is that we can do something about it. We know that resilience gives us this psychological strength to cope. And when we have it, we can be more productive. When we have it, it will reduce our likelihood of burnout. If we have it, it can help protect us against mental health problems. If we have it, and we can see people that do, we know that they're really good at nurturing relationships or listening and building trust. They're some of the things that we need. And the point is that we can develop it, because we can actually, if you will, we can trick the brain into thinking more positively. The brain cannot distinguish it. We have to control that. And for those of you who are more, I say more elderly, but I'm not that old, have had more life experience, let me tell you, life doesn't get any easier or more forgiving. But what we find is that we just get stronger and more resilient in order to be able to deal with it. So I'm just conscious of time. It's 22. So I'll carry on. I'll talk a bit quicker, Emma, because I think we have to finish on the hour.
I think you should. Yes, please. Yes. Thank you.
So I would normally do this with a questionnaire or a card sort. And what we would do with this is ask you, if you want to get your pen and paper, to think about how you're feeling about resilience. And so I'm going to put up our resilience profile here. It's with an organization, a business psychologist I work with. And on a bad day and on a good day, how do you normally feel? So I'm going to get rid of them because we haven't got a lot of time. I want you to have a look at the definitions. Again, it's just for you to do this. And I want you to read, on a bad day, on a good day, where would I score myself? What would I tend to do? How would I tend to feel? I just populated it there. So you can just write worried on the left-hand side, carefree on the right-hand side. And normally I would tend to feel quite anxious. So I'll score myself a 3. Pessimistic, optimistic? Normally I feel fairly positive about things. I score myself an 8. So I'm just going to give you a minute just to have a look at it. Again, no one's going to have a look at this, but just to get you to start thinking about how you tend to feel on a good day and a bad day. I can see Gilly has raised her hand.
Yes, Gilly. Simon, is this a good time for Gilly to ask her question?
Yeah, please, yeah.
It's just, I can't read the screen. Can you possibly increase the size of it?
I can't, Gilly. You know what? You're absolutely right. I have tried that. So let me say, let me apologise, because it's quite difficult. I'm straining forward to see. I would say don't worry about it. In the fullness of time, don't worry about it. But if you think about worried and carefree,
okay.
If you think about pessimistic and optimistic, and if you think about fierce and calm, that's fine. There's no more scientific. This is a psychometric assessment we would do, but it's just a bit of fun, just to get you to start thinking about it. Indeed, on that point, if anyone did want to do the full assessment, then you just need to contact me.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm just conscious of time because I want to talk about the habits, and I know what's coming next. So how can we use the habits that we talked about to build our resilience? So I talked about being proactive, taking responsibility for everything that happens to us. And this is based on the stimulus response theory. There's an event, COVID-19. There's a response, multiple responses, and there's an outcome, multiple outcomes. And we have the freedom to choose how we respond to COVID-19. Or to the weather, or to the fact that Emma, Arsenal are going to lose tonight. Arsenal are going to lose on Sunday. I'm going to be happy. Emma's going to be unhappy. I'll move on. We have two choices on how we respond. We can be what we call reactive. We can feel that we're being acted upon, that we're powerless, that we hold on to the past. I can't do anything right. Anything. Yes. Look at how I emphasize it. Or we can be proactive. We can say, I can take responsibility, be accountable, take control. Look, I might fail, but I will learn. And you can see that the emphasis is on the positive, on the optimistic. And so the point that I'm putting across is that we have that freedom to choose. So how can we use this to become more resilient? Well, what we can do is we can live in what we call the circle of influence. I can do it. I will do it. it's something that I'm it's going to be a challenge, but I'm going to give it a go. Or we can live in what we call the circle of concern. These are things we care about. We care about our colleagues, we care about our children, we care about the weather, but we can't do anything about it. And those sort of people, they've got those black clouds around their heads, they're negative, they blame other people. It's the government, it's the prime minister, it's the royal family or whatever. We have that choice. So one of the things that we can do is not try to solve problems with the same thinking that created them. That inner voice that we have, instead of saying, oh, Simon, you're useless, why are you doing this? You don't know what you're talking about, into an inner coach. Okay, that went okay, but how can we do it better, differently next time? We need to talk to ourselves. It's what we call cognitive restructuring. And we can shift our mindsets to see a problem as a potential learning process rather than an obstacle. And as William James said, if you can change your mind, you can change your life. I'm not saying it's easy, but if you don't do anything about it, nothing will change. And one analogy that we use all the time is this half empty, half full. Okay, so the half empty people, everything's a danger, warning sign, red flag. With the half full people that you know, that it's about opportunity. So the question is, how can we change that half empty into half full? We need to think. T in think stands for truth. When you say, am I telling the truth here, or am I actually lying to myself? The H is my thought being helpful? Is it being useful, or am I deluding myself? Is it inspiring me, or is it making me feel weaker and unhelpful? And the N is it necessary? Do I need to act on this thought or not? And the K is, am I being kind to myself, or do I need to change my thoughts? Now, for those of us who are more optimistic, then we can think those optimistic thoughts. We avoid the people that drain us. They're the energy drainers. And we're able to recognize when we need support. And we do that from a position of strength. So how many of you tend to be half full and how many of you tend to be half empty? If you go back to the reactions, it's the clapping hands if you're half full, and the very surprised face if you're half empty. So let's have a quick look. So I'm getting, it's going about 50-50 at the moment. Just change my screen. Oh, okay, on the screen. Okay, we're more half full, which is good. And we've got some thumbs up as well, which is great. Thank you. Okay, it's your choice. I'm just making you aware of it. Let's talk about habit number three, putting first things first. And this is about prioritizing what really matters. And we need to think about this. We need to say, okay, is it important? If it's important, it's going to be valuable to me. It's going to help me to meet my goals, my targets, my purpose. Or is it urgent? Do I have to do it straight away? And what we can do is we can look at a matrix. We've got somebody entering the room now, which is great. Better late than never. We can look at a matrix if it's urgent and important. Now, in quadrant one, we have what is called the quadrant of necessity. Got to be done. Crisis, burning platforms, pressing problems. The problem is if we stay in this quadrant for too long, this will naturally create stress. Equally, if we're doing stuff that's urgent, but it's not actually important, the interruptions, some meetings and emails and video calls and things like that, we can lose our tolerance when we're stressed. If it's not urgent and not important, we are completely wasting our time. And what a number of people were doing, I mean, talk about Prime and Netflix. I mean, we should have bought shares in them on the 22nd of March, because a lot of people have been doing that and have been used to doing that. But it's not a good place to spend most of your time. Where we need to spend our time is in the quadrant of quality. It's got to be important, but it mustn't be urgent. We need to prepare. We need to plan. We need to build relationships. So how can I become more resilient? Well, when you set your tasks for the day, literally say, is that task a 1, 2, 3, or 4? Stick to routine. Routines have been really important, and our routines were taken away last spring. And by the summer, we got into a different routine. But make sure you have frequent breaks. Make sure that you're talking to other people, having one-to-ones with people. And make sure you work in the present. Don't dwell on the past. You need to plan for the future. You need to anticipate that something might go wrong and build a contingency, but don't get stuck there. So I'd just like you just to write down, just for a bit of fun, for your own thinking, where do you think you spend most of your time? Is it in quadrant one, the quadrant of necessity, quadrant two, the quadrant of quality, quadrant three, the quadrant of deception, or quadrant four, the quadrant of waste? And if you're in any of them but number two, what can you do in your own time? What can you do to move away from that? So one of the questions I'd ask you, another Google search, write down productivity questionnaire by Mind Tools. Here's something I prepared earlier. You don't have to read this one, so please don't worry about that. But there are 16 statements. Answer them honestly. And then here's one I prepared earlier, just the red bullet points, whatever, ka-ching. And then it gives us some results. You don't have to be able to read them. So I'd like you to answer this question. You don't have to put, because I'm conscious of time. But if you think you're productive, write down yes. If not, no. Now, not now, but after this, go and do the questionnaire and just see whether your perception of being productive is actually the same as the reality. Just something for you to think about. It might be different. Let's move on to habit four, which is think win-win. I talk about this emotional bank account. And this is recognizing that there is a better way to accomplish what we want that is mutually beneficial to all sides. So like a bank account, we can put and invest in a relationship, or we can take things out of that relationship, we can withdraw. And when things go wrong, because you know what? They always do. You know, look at my logo, the peaks and troughs. It's because things are good sometimes, they're bad other times. If you invest in those deposits, you've got enough in your bank account, your emotional bank account, that somebody's going to be forgiving and tolerant, and it is going to be compassionate, and you can move on. So how can we use this to become resilient? Well, I don't know about you, but if I work with engaged, enthused and talented people, I become engaged, enthused and talented myself. It's called the law of attraction. And so in this environment, I've been surrounding myself with people who have become part of my mutual support group. As a coach, I have other coaches and we coach each other. Fantastic. I never had it before. It's great. The other thing that I talk to my clients about is being assertive, which is a challenge, and I could do a whole session on this, but it's telling people, how do you feel confidently, and also being able to say no confidently. And there are those people who have what we call a win-lose mentality. It's all about them, and they're very aggressive. They don't care about other people as long as they get what they want. But then there are other people who are what we call very passive. They're the lose winners. They allow people to intimidate them, and we don't get the best out of those people. Then those people who are just very, very aggressive, that take on very aggressive people, and they actually become very destructive. But ultimately, where I think we should be is in that win-win. It's what we call assertive. People who believe that there's enough for everybody, that they care for themselves and they care for other people as well, and they look for and can give mutual support. So I'm going to go to our third poll, and I'd like to know this time, how would you describe yourself? Let me just launch the poll. Would you see yourself as aggressive, passive, destructive, or assertive? Okay, let me emphasize, all of this is anonymous. It's just a bit of fun. We've had people voting in, everyone, which I like. Okay, about 70% of you have voted. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and we're going to end the poll. Okay. That's interesting. So most of you actually see yourselves as passive. I normally get assertive as the high one. It's quite high. But passive, that is very interesting. Again, we can't talk about it any more than that. It's thinking about, how do I move myself from people doing things unto me to be actually standing up for myself and having more parity in a relationship? That's very interesting. That surprised me. So the question is, are you a blamer? Let's see what.
How many of you are blamers? How many of you, when something goes wrong, the first thing you want to know is whose fault it is? Hi, my name is Brene. I'm a blamer. Let me just tell you this quick story. So this is a couple years ago when I first realized the magnitude to which I blame. I'm in my house. I have on white slacks and a pink sweater set, and I'm drinking a cup of coffee in my kitchen. It's a full cup of coffee. I drop it on the tile floor. It goes into a million pieces, splashes up all over me. And the first, a millisecond after it hit the floor,
right out of my mouth is this: damn you, Steve. Who's my husband? Because let me tell you how fast this works for me. So Steve plays water polo with a group of friends. And the night before, he went to go play water polo. And I said, hey, make sure you come back at 10, because, you know, I can never fall asleep into your home. And he got back like at 10:30. And so I went to bed a little bit later than I thought. Ergo, my second cup of coffee that I probably would not be having had he come home when we discussed. Therefore, and so the rest of that story is I'm cleaning up the kitchen. Steve calls, caller ID. I'm like, hey. He's like, hey, what's going on, babe? What's going on? So I'll tell you exactly what's going on. I'm cleaning up the coffee that spilled all, like dial tone. Because he knows. How many of you go to that place when something bad happens, the first thing you want to know is whose fault is it? I'd rather it be my fault than no one's fault. Because why? Why? Because it gives us some semblance of control. But here, if you enjoy blaming, this is where you should stick your fingers in your ear and do the no thing, because I'm getting ready to ruin it for you. Because here's what we know from the research. Blame is simply the discharging of discomfort and pain. It has an inverse relationship with accountability. Accountability, by definition, is a vulnerable process. It means me calling you and saying, hey, my feelings were really hurt about this, and talking. It's not blaming. Blaming is simply a way that we discharge anger. People who blame a lot seldom have the tenacity and grit to actually hold people accountable, because we expend all of our energy raging for 15 seconds and figuring out whose fault something is. And blaming is very corrosive in relationships, and it's one of the reasons we miss our opportunities for empathy. Because when something happens and we're hearing a story, we're not really listening. We're in the place where I was, making the connections as quickly as we can about whose fault something was.
Okay, so something for you to think about. Let's talk about sharpen the saw. And how can I become more resilient so I can refresh my mind, body, and spirit? Number one, we have to look after ourselves. If we don't look after ourselves, we can't look after other people. And we can do this by stimulating what we call the happiness chemicals. The first one is the dopamine. Completing a task, that feeling of achieving something, eating the right food, celebrating little wins, all of that creates this dopamine. The second one is what we call the love hormone, or the oxytocin. So if you're playing with the dog or playing with a baby or hugging your family, which we can't do at the moment, it's the virtual stuff, giving a compliment we can do. The fourth one is serotonin. That helps our moods. So all of that exercise, that's why exercise is so important. I'm taking vitamin D, even though I live on the South Coast and it's kind of the sun's gone in, but you know, I'm taking the vitamin D because that's been missing. Meditating, walking in nature, prayer would go in there. And the endorphins, that's all about laughing, essential oils, exercise, all those kind of things. So I'm not going to do the poll because we don't have time, but I just want you to think about, are you doing all of those habits? Because the important thing is that you should be doing at least one habit in each of those areas. So if everything is around exercising, that's not enough. So make a note of what you're doing, because you need all of those chemicals to help you manage your stress and build your resilience. Now, I can't show this one because Emma is plutzing there because of the time, which is a shame, because this is really funny. This will stimulate your endorphins. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to fast forward. It's a killer for me. It's my fault. I eat too much. I know it's my fault. So let's think about the key takeaways. For me, it's about making the habits a habit. Otherwise, if you don't take action, nothing's going to change. We need to have good stress because that helps us meet the demands of everyday life. We need to be aware of the things that stress us, and you made a note of that, but you need to take action. We know that resilience gives us this psychological strength. And if we choose to live in the circle of influence, that's a good thing. We can see the benefits, not the downsides. We can focus on our strengths, not those weaknesses. We can be half full, not half empty. We can be productive, not complacent. And absolutely make time for laughter, because that is, we've got to laugh. And I think Jews, we're very good at laughing at ourselves. So in conclusion, please make the habits a habit. if you want coaching, want to talk to me, just, you know, email me on LinkedIn, through Emma, whatever. 2 minutes for questioning.
I do have a question. Thank you. That's come to me anonymously. And the questioner has asked, Simon, they'd be interested in, really interesting, really good. How much of this applies if someone has a mental health condition?
Yes.
Or does it only apply? And the questioner has asked to normal people, in inverted commas. And I take that in the context it's written and you know, none other. You know, is that something that has a context that you'd like to address?
Yeah, yeah. The context that I would address, Emma, and thank you for the question, it's a very good question.
Yeah.
When I do this as a workshop, I make it very clear. I am an HR professional. I am a professional coach. I am not a psychiatrist. I am not a business psychologist. I'm not medically trained. So this is, as you're saying, for a normal work environment, which is what we were addressing today. Anyone who has any challenges that are medically required, then I am not qualified to deal with that. And I would say to any of my clients, make it very clear to them, then that is something that's outside my remit. Does that answer the question?
I think we all recognize also that everything is on a continuum. You know, it's very hard to say where barriers, where boundaries, where edges are, because everything seeks into something else, and you know, and it's very hard to draw those boundaries exactly. I mean, I there was so much material covered. It was you absolutely galloped through. There was so much to take in, Simon. It was absolutely wonderful. And you know, if anyone has questions, of course, that really they can reach out to Simon. His contact details are on the screen right now. I may just. Does anyone else have any other questions that they would like to address to Simon personally, through the webinar? It is technically 3 o'clock, but I'm sure we could take a couple of questions if anyone would like to ask. I think you've been so comprehensive in your material. I did particularly like the quadrants, I have to say, the quadrants of influence. I thought it was absolutely marvellous.
That's pure Covey. It's great.
Really, really. Alex has asked, can you just give a very briefly say a little bit more about rust out?
Yes. So, well, I know as much of it as I said, to be honest, but if we think about, and I've been in this situation where I've been in a job where actually I haven't been very busy, and I can see that my colleagues are busier than I am, and I start to feel guilty. And Parkinson's law, if you're aware of Parkinson's law, you fill the time with the time that you have available. So if you have, you know, whatever, 7 hours in a day, and you don't have much work, you stretch it out, and you can start to feel guilty. And what I was finding there is that actually I was losing my sharpness because I wasn't under enough pressure to really, I mean, you can tell I get very passionate and very enthusiastic about what I do. When I wasn't very busy in some of the jobs, you start to slow down. And in terms of rust, you start to literally, you can't move mentally, maybe physically or whatever. Does that help?
Thank you, yes. And very, very quickly, I think this will have to be our last question from Fenton. Any advice on resilience, on how to deal with redundancy for someone at a mature age who still needs to work? It's the big question of our times, isn't it? One of the big questions.
Well, I mean...
And hard to cover that succinctly, but a couple of tiny thoughts for Fenton.
Because I see myself as mature as well. I mean, I have written The 7 Habits of Highly Effective Job Seekers and work having you do these fantastic workshops on finding a job. So the very simple answer to that is you go and talk to Emma. I mean, I've been on their webinars and I've been doing this for 35 years or whatever. And I learn from the fantastic people at Work Avenue. So no, I don't, it's a mindset, Fenton, I think. It doesn't matter. Only if it matters in your own head.
Agree. Simon, thank you very, very much. A number of people have asked whether they can have the slides afterwards. So that's a question for you, Simon, if you're happy to share. If not, I completely understand, because the webinar itself will be available to review. You know, and maybe that's the way forward.
I think so. I think there's two things. Number one, you've got the recording. And number two, Emma, I'll send you what I've created called the Super Sevens. So the seven things that I would people that can take away. So they've got access to the webinar. They can listen to it again.
That's absolutely fine. So our webinar, thank you all. Our webinar will be available on our YouTube channel and also with a link from our website. It may not be from today, it may be from tomorrow, but really very, very swiftly, it will be available. So you will be able to revisit it. I thank you all so, so much for joining us this afternoon. It was so much information and so beautifully presented, Simon. I really enjoyed it, and I really believe and hope that everyone else did too. You know how to contact Simon. His contact details are there. You know how to contact me. It's through our website. My email address is on our website, or just ring the office and ask for me. Any of those can reach me. I, together with my team, are very, very reachable and very, very approachable for any information, advice and guidance. Melissa, thank you. Welcome to Work Avenue. Lovely to meet you. Do be in touch with anything we can help any of you with. Thank you all. The sun has gone in. That is a shame. Well, certainly where I'm sitting in Bushy Heath, the sun has gone in. I wish you all a super afternoon. You're very welcome. Do please be in touch if any of us can help with anything for any of you in the future. I thank you all and goodbye.
Thanks a lot.
Bye-bye now. If I could ask you all to leave the webinar. Bye-bye now.
Thanks very much. Bye, Simon. Nice to meet you.